Okay, welcome back from lunch. Hope you enjoyed the violin serenading of James Grasek. And so we're back now in business. Our next panel is going to explore the tax planning techniques for capitalizing a U.S. group by foreign investors. As the United States' effective tax rate, considering federal and state and local, is among the highest in the world, obviously capitalizing a U.S. group in the form of an instrument that the U.S. would regard as interest-bearing debt would be tax efficient. And it would even be more interesting if the home country, the investing countries, would view the same instrument as equity, particularly if that jurisdiction has a participation exemption with respect to dividends. We're going to explore that and other topics in this panel. Leading this panel is Fred Gander. Fred is an international Washington National tax partner resident in London, and Fred heads the firm's U.S. tax practice for all of Europe and the Middle East. Joining Fred include representatives of three foreign jurisdictions, which we thought would be quite interesting to get their perspective on how they view tax planning in capitalizing a U.S. group from their perspective as well. And they would include Marko, Gruendig. Marko heads the German Tax Center based in New Jersey. Kees van Meel heads the Netherlands Center based in New York. And Bastien, Voisin, who heads the Luxembourg Center based in New York. We selected these particular countries to join the panel today, as besides the UK and Japan, the Netherlands, Germany, Switzerland, Canada, France, and Luxembourg are among the highest direct investors in the United States, according to a recent report issued by the United States Congressional Research Service. Gentlemen.
Thank you, Larry. I hope everyone is relaxed and well-fed after lunch, and welcome back. As Larry said, we've got a collection of Europeans here, including, I guess, myself. I've spent 20-some years over in London, so bring pretty much a European perspective as well to some of these issues. We're going to divide our 50 minutes really into two halves. The first half is largely I'm going to present some sort of emerging issues and topics that we see from our client base in terms of non-U.S.-based multinationals and the issues that they're facing in terms of financing their U.S. operations. Some recent cases that relate to debt equity classification, some earnings stripping discussions. And then we're going to get into a little bit of what Danielle opened up, BEPS, but maybe from a European perspective. And as that relates specifically to the future of hybrid instruments, hybrid entities, hybrid ownership of assets, et cetera. And then jump into a few case studies that have been selected by my colleagues with respect to some financing techniques that are used by multinationals based in their various jurisdictions. And we'll have a bit of dialogue and give and take about those case studies. So with that as introduction, we'll move forward. In planning for this presentation, one of the first things I wanted to do was sit down and sort of identify what I experienced as being sort of the primary considerations that a non-U.S. multinational has to deal with when contemplating how to finance its U.S. operations. And I came up with these, I think, 9 bullet points that I think are the critical issues that you have to run the gauntlet, so to speak, of all of these various areas of U.S. tax law and the like. And each one of them presents some very significant issues that have to be thought through, carefully considered, and the like. Many of them we've already discussed in some of the panels, 163J, the earnings stripping rules, the debt equity classification under the myriad of U.S. cases dealing with those types of issues. Heightened audit activity. Clearly, the U.S. Internal Revenue Service has identified inbound financing and base erosion using debt as a top issue in terms of the audits of multinational corporations. Those corporations are feeling that pressure, believe me. Transfer pricing principles, setting arm's length interest rates, setting royalty levels that will pass scrutiny, evaluating what is an acceptable debt-to-equity leverage model. Those are all complicated issues that people grapple with. The conduit financing regulations and case law, like I know David Rosenblum mentioned Dell Commercial, those types of conduit financing cases or economic substance cases. The anti-hybrid regulations, the 894, the reverse hybrid rules and the hybrid entity rules, and various hybrid entity treaty provisions. The complex LOB provisions in virtually all US treaties these days. Then we come on to whether existing structures are sustainable. That is, there's an increasing change of law risk that tax directors have to cope with, both from the United States side of things, but also in their home jurisdiction. And quickly, overnight almost, structures that have been in place for years may have to be completely thought through again and perhaps consigned to the dustbin, and replacements need to be found. I think, again, David mentioned the increasing possibility that economic substance or general anti-avoidance rules will be applied in the context of cross-border inbound financing. And of course, we all know that there's potential discussion now of additional limitations on the deductibility of interest by U.S. debtors. And potentially, that could filter into tightening of the screws, if you will, on the 163J earnings stripping provisions. Okay, with that as sort of background of sort of the technical minefield that has to be navigated, I'm sure all of us in the room could add another half a dozen points to that brief list. But with that as background, what are some of the issues that currently are facing tax directors in non-US-based multinationals? Again, sort of a list from our own practice at KPMG that we're coming across increasingly. Obviously, as I mentioned, it's getting to be a tougher world, both from the US perspective and increased audit scrutiny, but also audit scrutiny from, in particular, European jurisdictions that are looking at hybrid instruments and various financing techniques, participation exemptions, economic substance, et cetera. So companies are getting it from both sides, if you will. Another issue is the problem of guarantee fees and setting debt guarantees by foreign parents. What's the arm's length appropriate fee? Does the guarantee cause 163J earnings stripping limitations? And how to deal with guarantee fees in terms of deductibility and the like. Another issue, given the extremely low interest rate environment that we face currently, is a number of multinationals who put in debt financing several years ago when we were in a much higher rate environment are now finding those instruments are maturing. And current interest rates obviously reduce the base erosion potential for a given amount of debt principal. So people are trying to preserve the overall effective tax rate benefits by finding ways to leverage, obviously, the U.S. operations up to the legal permissible thresholds. But the low rate environment does complicate that considerably. We also quite often deal with intra-group debt and advances where, for various reasons, no documentation was executed. Multinational corporations can sometimes be lax in terms of entering into formal legal documents when they're moving money around their worldwide operations. And often they come to us and say, well, what do we do now? Is this valid debt? Is it equity, et cetera? So those are issues that sometimes people are grappling with. In other situations, they do have formal legal documentation, but for various reasons, they haven't really complied with the letter and the terms and conditions of that documentation. And we'll see an example of that in the recent Scottish Power case that we're going to look at in a couple of minutes. Obviously, I mentioned that there's change of law risk, and how do you deal with replacing the benefits of a debt structure that all of a sudden no longer works. And no U.S. tax presentation would be complete, I think, without at least some passing reference to FATCA. Worldwide multinationals have to pay attention to see if there's any FATCA ramifications to their financing techniques. And then, very refreshing to hear Danielle say that we shouldn't be moralizing about base erosion, and it's up to governments to establish the legal parameters, and they shouldn't sort of give away their sort of obligations to legislate by simply pointing the finger at morality and the like. But in Europe, believe me, morality and reputation risk is a very significant problem. Gentlemen, I think you would agree that the landscape in Europe on morality, whatever that may mean in real life, is quite different, I think, than what we face in the U.S. Do you want to provide some comments on that?
Yeah, let me take a shot at it. We've all seen what's happening in the U.K. There's sort of a public outrage about companies not paying tax. Tax is sort of in the spotlight at the moment. I heard somebody say tax used to be understood by few, and now it's misunderstood by everybody, and that's sort of the the environment. And people are in the UK. You hear people say, "Oh gosh, Amazon is killing our mom and pop stores. Go to the mom and pop stores." Well, everybody who has seen the movie *You Got Mail* with Meg Ryan and Tom Hanks knows that mom and pop stores going bust has nothing to do with tax. It's just a matter of economies of scale. So, but the thing is, everybody's upset. And what do you do as a government? You have to do something. If everybody's yelling, you got to do something, then you got to do something. So that's sort of the whole background and the whole environment that we're living in Europe at the moment.
And the views are not shared across even the EU uniformly. I mean, Luxembourg would, and perhaps the Netherlands, have different perspectives on this than, say, the UK, Germany, and France. So, Bastien, you want to comment?
Yeah, well, it's a little bit particular for Luxembourg because we are really an intermediate offshore jurisdiction. But Luxembourg recently, for instance, transposed an EU directive which provides for a spontaneous exchange of information on hybrid instruments, for instance, 2 weeks ago. So, yeah, they already take some measures about it.
And Marko, in Germany, I know Danielle mentioned the press about this is only an American multinational problem, but what's the view from Germany?
Well, I mean, as Danielle said correctly, I mean, German companies don't engage in BEPS, so therefore it's not an issue at all. the fact of the matter is German companies, of course, do engage in BEPS strategies, therefore it is a big issue. Of course, the way it's portrayed by the media is a lot different. One, it primarily looks at the foreign-based multinationals who strip their German operations and strip out profits from a high-tax country like Germany as they can. So obviously, the discussion around this morality and whether there is a second standard of assessing the tax in terms of what is legitimate or not plays a big role. Although I think that the German government is well aware of the fact that ultimately it's up to the legislator to make the relevant changes. And they also know that German companies as well basically wrote their foreign subsidiaries, and that is the other side of that discussion where Germany benefits from a lot.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Let's move on to a couple of cases. I know David mentioned Dell Commercial. It's one of my favorites as well. And I think for purposes of this discussion, I won't go through the facts. We'll just put a little diagram up. The relevance to this discussion, I think one of the bullet points talked about, well, if you're going to have legal documents and loan agreements, it's really nice if you actually live by the terms and conditions of them. It's really helpful to your case in terms of sustaining a debt treatment and avoiding conduit type issues or economic substance issues. Here at Dell Commercial, after making a few interest payments to the Dutch lender, Dellcom BV, there at the bottom of the chain, started making interest payments direct to the Canadian parent, Dellcom Financial, sort of disregarding its own form. And often we do see that in the multinational context, that for whatever reason internally they can't sort of get the chairs arranged correctly on the deck, and they end up committing some significant foot faults and disregarding their own form. I think also, obviously, this case really predates the conduit financing regulations, and those might well have applied in this situation, albeit there's an equity investment into the Netherlands. And in case you and I were discussing the other day when we were preparing for this, it's unclear how they base eroded out of the Netherlands. There was a Barbados branch with a part-time employee, and Could that have been it, where that the interest income from the U.S. was for Dutch purposes earned by a PE?
Assuming that the org chart is right, that's what I can imagine, because normally you would say, hey, if a Dutch company is equity funded and receives interest income, it's going to be taxed on it, right? So what's the planning? And even if there will be withholding, you will be able to credit it. So what I think happened in this case, and they had something in Barbados, they may have gotten a ruling in the Netherlands where they say, okay, we have a branch in Barbados, and that's where the money is managed, and therefore we can allocate the income to the branch, and therefore there should be no tax because the Barbados income is exempt at the level of the head office. That's the only thing I can think of.
Yeah, this case dates back to, I think, 1999, so it's a bit old news now. But in reading it in preparation for this conference, I remember that the taxpayer, particularly on appeal, made a strong case that the Canadian tax savings from creating essentially exempt dividend income in Canada was a significant non-U.S. tax reduction purpose that legitimized the structure because it wasn't a U.S. tax avoidance driving force. It was just one outcome was a reduction of the dividend rate from or interest withholding rate from 15% to zero, but they achieved a greater Canadian tax savings from the exemption. The appeals court sort of rejected that, but only on the grounds that, for whatever reason, the taxpayer hadn't presented significant enough demonstration or evidence that they had achieved that benefit. But it was interesting that the taxpayer tried to say, well, we achieved a greater foreign tax savings than U.S. tax savings, so our structure ought to be respected. Let's look at a more recent case. I call it Scottish Power. I think the formal name is NA General Partnership. At the time, it was a UK-based utility, Scottish Power, making an acquisition of Pacific Corp. And the case was decided in June last year, but the transaction occurred many years earlier, back before the 894 reverse domestic hybrid rules were issued. And this was a technique very often used in financing U.S. acquisitions, where Scottish Power essentially sold some of its own equity to a newly created U.S. general partnership in exchange for two notes, a large fixed rate note of, I think, $4 billion, and a floating rate note of about $900 million. And then NAGB used that stock as consideration in an acquisition of Pacific Corp. And so we're talking about a large, almost $5 billion debt structure here. And the IRS tried to deny the interest deductions, took Scottish Power to court, and ended up losing. But here's an example, unlike Dell Commercial, where the taxpayer's sort of disregard or non-compliance with the terms of its agreement didn't seem to get it into much trouble. For example, they missed the first 4 out of 5 interest payments because of issues down at Pacific Corp. There was an inability to declare sufficient dividends up to NAGP in time to make interest payments. So much so that NAGP went out and borrowed first from the Scottish Power Group to finance some interest payments, and then later on from RBS to finance additional interest payments, and then eventually got dividends out of Pacific Corp and was able to repay RBS and the like. But then eventually, in consultation with its Big Four advisor, I think it was PwC, they decided that perhaps the floating rate notes were susceptible to recharacterization as equity, so they capitalized that into equity. They then, after the 894 regs were issued sometime in 2002, by the end of 2002, they capitalized most of the fixed rate $4 billion note. And the service said, well, that capitalization, that failure to make interest payments, demonstrated really that the debt should be treated as equity. And the court didn't buy that argument. There was sort of a battle of expert witnesses. The court, I think, didn't resort at all to sort of economic substance and wasn't particularly bothered by sort of the double dip type nature of the arrangement, but stuck to traditional debt equity factor analysis that we've all seen many times before, and sort of one by one went through those 11 factors and concluded that in this case, debt treatment was appropriate. For example, they said that it was clear that the taxpayer had projections, reasonable projections, that Pacific Corp was going to have sufficient dividend income to enable the debt to be serviced. They had evidence that the debt would have been rated no worse than B if this had been issued in the public markets, and the court felt that that was still a B-rated debt is still debt. And you know, the court just felt that on balance this was valid lending and sustained something like $900 million of interest deductions. And a couple of interesting comments by the court here on this screen is that in a related party context, they understandably offer more flexible terms than could be obtained elsewhere. They also said that we don't need to establish that the U.S. sub could have borrowed on the same terms. We just need to be able to establish that it could borrow on substantially similar terms. Furthermore, it said in a related party context, we're looking for whether it's a patent distortion of what would normally have been available to a debtor in arm's length transaction. So the court, I think, expressed some flexibility that perhaps is a bit surprising to some of us, that related party loans can sometimes still be respected as debt, even if the parties don't act like a true arm's length lender would and, say, demand payment at the first sign of a default. Earnings stripping, I think we won't make any real comments here of any great length. They've been with us for almost 20-some years. I think it's a very formulary approach. It works. Many European countries have essentially copied the earnings stripping provisions one shape or another. Obviously, U.S. multinationals, foreign-based multinationals have to deal with the rules. They're concerned that they'll be tightened down further in the search for revenue. But generally, they don't cause a lot of problems. You run the numbers and you live with the ratios and the like. Any observations, gentlemen, on that?
No, I agree.
It's sort of old and tried and tested ground. Simple cross-border preference share repo. Very prevalent both within internal group financing from virtually all the countries represented here and others in Europe in particular. 20-some years of using this type of structure. From our perspective, just for those of you that aren't familiar with it, this is a very simple diagram, but essentially U.S. sub capitalizes one of its U.S. subsidiaries with preference shares, then sells those preference shares to foreign parent with a repurchase obligation at some point in the future. And from a U.S. law perspective, we treat that as a secured financing whereby the U.S. parent is borrowed from the foreign parent, secured by a pledge of the preferred stock, but if done correctly in the foreign parent jurisdiction, they treat that as a purchase of the preferred stock and that the dividends coming up on the preferred are participation exempt or in some cases carry underlying credits for U.S. tax paid. Still works, still being done broadly. Is mentioned in the OECD reports on hybrids. They call this hybrid ownership, where two countries look at the transaction and reach different conclusions as to who owns the preferred shares. Marko, I know repos in Germany still doing them.
Yeah, I mean, they're frequently used by German multinationals in financing their U.S. operations. They're available in different types of structures. And I've actually seen a few of these repos audited by the IRS here in the U.S. And an interesting experience that I made in that regard was that the IRS was asking for a copy of the translated German tax opinion. And as you can imagine, like the U.S. tax opinion, the German tax opinion is a more comprehensive document. But the IRS wasn't necessarily interested in understanding how German tax law worked, but what they actually did is they reviewed whether the facts and representations that were made for U.S. purposes and for German purposes were identical, so that, you know, we didn't turn around from a German perspective and said the loan is never going to be repaid. which I think underlines, Fred, what you had said earlier about the form of the agreements that they're being actually executed and lived. And from an economic perspective, you know, the clients take consistent positions in both countries.
From sort of my experience, the Internal Revenue Service has audited a number of these types of transactions, but I'm not aware of any that they ended up proposing an adjustment. So that they've looked at repos, as I said, they've been around at least since the early 90s, and there's been no sort of pronouncement trying to shut them down and the like. But lo and behold, under BEPS or the attack on hybrids generally, we may find that this type of transaction is no longer acceptable. And that is a significant change from the attitude that the U.S. is just applying with its blinders, its debt equity and asset ownership rules, and we're going to apply those regardless of how the other side of the transaction is going to apply their rules, and there's nothing wrong with that. And that, you know, during the 30 years I practiced tax law, those were the rules. But we seem to be on the verge of entering into a new age where that just may not be acceptable any longer. Yes.
Yeah, maybe I will add that in my experience, I've seen very few repo structures with Luxembourg. And I think one of the main reasons is that repo structures work perfectly with jurisdiction, industrial jurisdiction like Germany or the UK. So there is no real need of using Luxembourg for this type of mm-hmm. structure.
Yeah, we looked at it as well, but we couldn't get too comfortable because the U.S. wants no risk, and in order to make it work from a Dutch point of view, you want risk, and it sort of gave sort of a friction. Those issues don't exist in the U.K. or in Germany, so.
Well, I wouldn't say they don't exist, but well, we can manage them.
Easier to navigate. Okay, let's turn to recent OECD and EU activity on mismatches. Again, Danielle sort of set the stage here. In March of 2012, the OECD published a paper on hybrid mismatches and included various recommendations, basically suggestions that unilateral fixes, such as in the case of a hybrid instrument, that perhaps the creditor country ought to follow the debtor country's characterization. So if it was a deductible payment in the debtor country, then the creditor should have a law that says it will be an includable taxable interest income rather than exempt dividend in our country, in the creditor country. They suggested general anti-avoidance rules, specific anti-avoidance rules, and rules addressing, you know, various hybrid mismatches. Following on from that, in December of last year, the European Commission adopted a series of recommendations also dealing with hybrid mismatches, and a group so-called the EU Code of Conduct Group, really picking up on the OECD's earlier March 2012 report, and suggested similar types of provisions within the EU. These would be focused on hybrid transactions within the common market as opposed to from the EU to the United States. So they made these various proposals, including potentially an EU directive.
Right.
You want to comment on that?
I think one of the things that should be mentioned here as well is the initiative to implement a common consolidated tax base in Europe, because that, at least within Europe, would take care of a lot of these issues that we see here. Because if the European countries would start harmonizing their tax laws and allocate income on a consolidated basis and allocated based on factors like assets, revenues, and payroll, a lot of these issues wouldn't exist. Surprisingly, the proposals to implement that CCTDB have been stalled, and I don't see right now why the EU is not picking up on them, especially in light of this discussion here.
Again, then, following the EU's publication in December, we had BEPS in February, which obviously includes a discussion on hybrid instruments, hybrid entities, tax treatment of group debt financing, and the effectiveness of anti-avoidance rules and GARs on thin cap, et cetera. So clearly this type of financing activity is in the crosshairs, if you will, of the BEPS project. And in fact, I think most of us feel that it's one area where it's reasonable to expect some real action coming out of these discussions, because I think it's somewhat of the low-hanging fruit. What are the possible solutions? Mutual recognition, for example, in terms of hybrid finance, following the qualification of the debtor state, as I mentioned. If it's debt in the debtor state, then it'll be debt in the creditor state, or vice versa. For hybrid entity, following the qualification of the state of establishment. So perhaps no more disregarded entities if these rules were to come in. For hybrid permanent establishments, that's a permanent establishment that, for example, exists under Luxembourg law but does not exist for U.S. purposes because there's not enough substance in the PE for it to rise to a PE for our purposes. So what we might expect is solutions that try to reach mutual treatment on these types of these mismatches and therefore avoid stateless income or double non-taxation, whichever characterization you prefer. Observations, predictions?
I mean, I could imagine that, especially the proposals on hybrid finance and entities, that's probably more an issue for the Netherlands and for Luxembourg, which are countries where these instruments have been used a lot. From a German perspective, I mean, the items that the OECD report brings forward are not necessarily new, aside from the discussion around the IP ownership and the use of IP. We have seen in the past a lot of legislation attacking hybrid financing structures, and I expect to see that going forward as well. So therefore, I think Germany, my feeling is that Germany is looking to the OECD to propose how to deal with those issues. But as far as the domestic side is concerned, I mean, they were always aware of these structures. We do have GAR rules. We do have specific anti-avoidance rules. That isn't necessarily new.
Yeah, I guess the same applies sort of for the Netherlands. I mean, a lot of large Dutch companies have an arrangement with the revenue. They call it horizontal monitoring. And they discuss all their structuring and what have you. So there's no really unpleasant surprises to be expected. I think the only thing is you can, for instance, still in the Netherlands have a ruling from the revenue that an instrument, for instance, with France qualifies as equity in the Netherlands and as debt in France. And I guess if action is to be taken, it shouldn't be done just on an EU basis, because if that happens, then arguably the other big industrialized countries like the US and Japan would have benefits. So I expect that something's going to be done within the OECD. And again, it is tough, but the pressure is on, and the public opinion is really about paying fair share and what have you. So, yeah. I think stuff is going to happen.
Something will happen. Bash?
Yeah, this is maybe for me a good transition to present the next structure.
Maybe, Bastien, one thing I think what is interesting and what is a key concern of the German government is actually information exchange. Not necessarily in a corporate context, primarily because the German government is very concerned about individuals hiding their money in some offshore jurisdiction. And therefore, I think, as far as Germany is concerned, every other week we see a new treaty with some islands that we have now a full information exchange. I think the last one I've seen was with the Cook Islands, where we have a full information exchange as well now. And I guess within the European Union, there are two countries under pressure. One is Luxembourg, the other one is Austria. And I guess there's some movement in Luxembourg around that, right?
Yeah. I would say that the banking secrecy will disappear in 2015 in Luxembourg. Yeah? So, but this relates to interest payments for individuals.
Right.
So this is really in the context of individual, not so much corporations.
Right. Okay. Bastien, why don't you walk us through the first structure here?
Yeah, so this Luxembourg financing structure that involves a U.S. branch is particularly efficient in the context of U.S. inbound financing activities, since it offers two main advantages. First, it allows for a reduced effective taxation for the Luxembourg beneficiary on US source interest income. And this is made possible by way of the tax treaty that grants the right to tax revenues to the residence country of the permanent establishment to which these revenues are allocated. So such structure requires that most of the loans, saying 95%, to be allocated from the Luxembourg head office to its US branch. And as a result, only the interest income generated on 5% of the loans is taxable in Luxembourg, while the income generated on 95% of the loans does not fall in the definition of a US trade or business, so is not seen as a ECI and is not taxable in the US nor in Luxembourg.
Yes, obviously the difficulty is in that last bit, which is to get something that's a branch from your perspective that doesn't rise to a branch or an ECI presence from the US perspective. It is possible. It's been done, as you correctly point out, but it's not easy.
Yeah.
And this is a classic example of hybridity or hybrid entity or where you've got a mismatch between the rules of the two countries.
Yeah, you're right here. There is somewhere a tension between the substance that is required from a Luxembourg standpoint to consider this US branch as a PE, and also the US consideration in order to avoid that there is not too much substance in the US in order not to fall in the US trade or business. But I would say the main benefit of a structure is to avoid the triangular case issue. Indeed, the limitation on benefits provision in the tax treaty states that US source interest does not benefit from the treaty provisions if it is paid to a low tax permanent establishment of a third country and results in reducing the overall taxation of the Luxembourg company by more than 50%. But in our case, the branch is not located in a third country, but in the US. So this provision should not apply.
Okay. Let's go on to the next structure.
So this other Luxembourg financing structure is specifically implemented by Canadian entities investing in the US. The funds are allocated by the Canadian parent corporation to a new Luxembourg branch, then contributed to a new Luxembourg subsidiary, which in turn onlends the funds to the US. And from a Luxembourg standpoint, the branch is considered acting as an internal bank, and as such is assumed to have a solvency ratio of 92-8. As a result, some deemed interest expenses are imputed on the notional debt financing portion of 92% that are tax deductible at the level of the branch. And this is by means of the tax consolidation that these notional deemed interest expenses recognized at the level of the branch, and the US source interest income generated by the Luxembourg subsidiary are netted down to a taxable margin.
Okay, and I think we don't have a treaty shopping problem here because of the NAFTA residency of the Canadian parent. So from a US perspective?
Yeah, I think that there is no anti-conduit rules concern. Since the modification of the treaty between
yes, with Canada
US and
down
Canada.
At zero now.
Yeah.
Okay, Marko, over to Germany.
Yeah, I mean the first financing structure isn't something that any administration should be concerned about, and it is a structure that you will find with many German multinationals. They typically set up a treasury center. Normally that's in the Netherlands. Sometimes you can have that. Some of German multinationals have it in Luxembourg as well, that they use as their vehicle to issue or to take out bank loans as well as issue public bonds. And that vehicle is effectively a conduit and on lends to the rest of the worldwide group. The reason why German multinationals do that is an awkward rule in our trade tax law. As you may know, Germany has two types of income taxes. One is the corporate income tax. It's a 15.8% effective rate. And then there's the trade tax, which ranges from 12 to 17%, depending on where the operations of a German multinationals are based. And for trade tax purposes, interest expense is only 75% deductible as a default rule. So therefore, if the German multinational would take out a bank loan or issue a public debt and on-lend that to the rest of the worldwide group, the interest deduction for trade tax purposes is limited to 75%. So effectively, if German multinational would be used as the intermediary in that financing arrangement, there's a small tax ranging from 3 to 4% that's left in Germany. So as a consequence, German multinationals have used foreign entities to do the financing function. You could think about this as a small event of base eroding the German trade tax base, but it's been accepted and it's been implemented numerous times. Therefore, from a German perspective, the issues on that structures are really limited. And from a US perspective, I guess, Fred, the question is, I guess there's nothing artificial or really bad about this arrangement. No. Effectively, it's the forwarding of external loans, but I understand there is a couple of limitations from a US perspective.
Well, you do have to run through the conduit financing regulations, but with public debt or bank loans from a bank in a treaty jurisdiction, most likely you won't have any issue in terms of withholding tax. So it's manageable, I think.
Right, so the key issue is securing the US, the 0% withholding tax rate under the US-Dutch treaty, and if you can do that, I think, other than debt equity and 163J,
yes,
should be manageable.
Absolutely.
If we go more into the direction of a direct financing between Germany and the US, I think the first basic question is, should we use debt or equity? If there is an equity funding, of course, the payment on an equity instrument is normally not deductible from a US perspective, and Germany has a participation exemption regime. However, it's not a full participation exemption of dividend income. It's effectively limited to a 95% participation regime. And so on every dividend or capital gain that a German company makes from the disposal of a US company or from the receipt of a dividend from a US company, effectively there's a small tax of 1.5%, which is 5% the taxable amount of the dividend or capital gain times the German tax rate, which is about 30%. So having an equity instrument in place will result in some small tax if there is ever a remuneration paid on that equity instrument or if a capital gain is realized. Putting a debt instrument in place will give a small benefit simply because the US tax rate is currently higher than the German tax rate, and because under the treaty between the US and Germany, there's normally a 0% withholding tax on the interest payment. So as long as the US doesn't reduce its corporate income tax rate, generally a debt financing arrangement is preferential from a pure tax perspective over an equity instrument. The one thing that German multinationals are concerned about if debt instruments are being used is the currency implications. I'm not sure if any one of you has followed the euro-US dollar exchange rate over the past few years, but there were quite some movements between the euro and the US dollars, and as currency effects are generally taxable or tax deductible item, they can easily recapture any benefit that's potentially gained by using the arbitrage in the tax rate between the US and Germany. So therefore, I mean, as a general, but from a pure tax perspective, I think right now we like to have debt instruments because of the higher US tax rate compared to the German rate. And of course that brings us into the next question. If a debt instrument is preferred because of the US tax rate is higher, the question is, can we improve that somewhat and turn it into a hybrid debt, which effectively creates a deduction from a US perspective and gets access to the 40% tax benefit over here and generates tax-exempt or at least 95% tax-exempt income at the level of the German recipient. And what I can tell you is that there's a number of different techniques and structures out there that have been used and effectively been implemented by German multinationals. But the legislator is not silent about that. They put forward a lot of rules that make it harder to implement these types of structure. And also the treaty, the current treaty between the US and Germany makes it a lot harder to use treaty benefits that were granted under the old treaty. For a number of reasons, the new treaty has a hybrid entity clause. And also, I mean, at the level of the German parent, we normally exempt foreign income that's being taxable in the US. However, Article 23 contains a rule that Germany switches over from the exemption to the credit method if there is a conflict in qualification of an item of income, and as a result of that, the income is not taxed in the US, although the expectation is that it would normally be taxable in the US. In addition, Germany has implemented domestic anti-treaty override rules where we, under domestic law, override the treaty and simply do not apply the treaty exemption in certain circumstances, particularly if there's a conflict of qualification, which is somewhat similar to Article 23.4 in that regard. And a very recent proposal, and I think Fred has alluded to that before, is an expansion of what we call the principle of corresponding taxation, which would limit the application of our participation exemption regime to dividends if the payor of the dividend is entitled to a tax deduction on that dividend. That was not been the case so far, so we would just look under German domestic law what constitutes a dividend, and if it's a dividend, then the general rule is that the dividend is 95% exempt, and that proposed law would effectively limit that exemption to situations where the payor is not entitled to a tax deduction on that payment.
Okay, thank you. Kees?
Yes, the US is not the best known tax haven, so I thought I'll tickle your interest a little bit by using the US as a tax haven. If you look at the linker situation, the left side, we have a Dutch parent that has granted a loan to an operational company, receives interest deductible at the level of the OPCO and taxable at the level of the Dutch parent. Pretty straightforward. What are we going to do? We're going to create a US limited partnership, which under Dutch classification rules qualifies as non-transparent, and on the US rules is transparent. We are dropping the OPCO shares in the US limited partnership, and then we have the structure as it shows on the right. Now, the Dutch parent makes a capital contribution to the US limited partnership, who in its turn grants a loan to the OPCO. From a Dutch perspective, the interest that the OPCO will pay to the US limited partnership is not taken into account in the Netherlands because it's interest paid between two affiliates, two subsidiaries. And from a US perspective, the partnership is just a contract on the US law. There's no US trade or business, so there would be no US tax. So this would, as such, work very nice, but let's assume that the OPCO will be a resident of the US. Then we have a problem, I think, because the US makes an interest payment to the US limited partnership. From a US perspective, the payment is made to the Netherlands, but the treaty has an anti-hybrid provision that says if interest is paid through an entity that is transparent under the laws of either state and is transparent in the US, then you only get treaty benefits to the extent that the income, the interest paid to the OP, is reported as income of a resident of the Netherlands, which is not the case. So this does not work if the subsidiary is in the US. You may also have issues with any other country that has a withholding tax on interest. If they don't look through the LP, you would have a problem, but basically this would work nicely. And from a Dutch perspective, you can have the participation exemption with respect to the US limited partnership if the US limited partnership on a consolidated basis is active. And sort of a litmus test is to see if more than 50% of the assets of the LP, including assets of the operational company, are active, and if that's the case, you get a participation exemption. If it's not the case, there's another rule in the Netherlands that you can then still get the participation exemption if the subsidiary is subject to tax at a reasonable rate, which is 10%, but obviously the USLP is not subject to tax, so you would flunk that test. But as long as on the balance the assets are active, you should be able to claim the participation exemption. Therefore, you've effectively created a double dip by using the most unknown tax haven being the US. Next slide.
Kees, just let me make one comment on that and go back to your earlier comment that you made about taxes misunderstood by many now. I recently read an article in a German newspaper where the state of Delaware was portrayed as a tax haven. I haven't fully understood why, but one of the comments that was made in that article was that apparently you can form a company in Delaware and exempt foreign income there. And I assume this must have been something like that. The issue with that whole thing and tax evasion or tax haven is that you could do that with a German KG as well. So in a certain way, Germany would be a tax haven as well if I follow the rationale of that author there. Yep. But this is a real good example of how this is being portrayed in the press in Europe and how a lot of people misunderstand what the issues are really about.
This structure is sort of a variation to the theme. In the Netherlands, we have the concept of fiscal unity, which is a tax consolidation, and transactions between members of the fiscal unity are disregarded. So we have the parent gives within the Dutch fiscal unity a loan to its subsidiary, and the subsidiary puts the money into a US LLC, which has business activities. The BV2 is a taxpayer in the US, and it will have to report the income from its business. And in the US return, it can deduct interest to the extent it relates to the US business. And given the fact here that the LLC is the sole asset of the Dutch company, BV2, arguably all the interest that it has paid to BV1 would be deductible in the US corporate income tax return. So basically the same outcome. The interest payment between BV2 and BV1 is disregarded in the Netherlands, so no income pickup. And in the US, you get a deduction. There's, again here, it's mentioned that beware of Article 24.4. You have to take into account, again, the anti-hybrid provision of the treaty. And to the extent that the LLC would have remittance of deemed, I guess you could call it a deemed dividend amount, mm-hmm. to the extent nothing is paid to the Netherlands, the Dutch company does not report any income, only because the Dutch company regards the LLC as a subsidiary. So only if there's an actual dividend, it will report income. So if there's a dividend equivalent amount that is not reported as income in the Netherlands, again, 24.4 kicks you out of the treaty, the hybrid provision, because the item of income is not treated as income of a resident of the other state.
And I guess if the Netherlands were to adopt a rule that simply said, when it comes to a hybrid entity like the LLC, that it will follow the characterization of the country of organization, then this would disappear. This benefit.
Well, it would still work, I guess, but we would have a problem in the Netherlands with the tax relief, because we need the subsidiary to be a non-transparent entity, because otherwise in the fiscal unity rules, there are some rules that would avoid the benefit.
Okay.
Okay, that takes us to the final slide. This is a little bit more complicated, but you see the two dotted lines are a US tax group and a Dutch tax group. And what happens here is the Dutch parent and the subsidiary create a US general partnership, which on the Dutch rules is a transparent entity. So the general partnership in fact belongs to the parent and the subsidiary. In the US, you make an election for the GP to be treated as a company. The GP wants to acquire or capitalize a subsidiary, so it takes up a loan from a bank and pays interest to the bank. From a Dutch perspective, because the GP is transparent, the fiscal unity is deemed to have taken up the bank loan and gets a deduction. And from a US perspective, because the GP is in the consolidated group with the US opcos, you get a deduction against the operating income of the US subsidiaries.
And this is Scottish power, essentially, except instead of having the loan in the US GP be from the Dutch parent, it comes from a third party, and as such, the 894 domestic reverse hybrid rules don't apply, so you get the deduction. And there's no recharacterization. So this one that still works.
Yeah.
Okay, I think we're out of time. This is slightly off subject, but Kees, tell me a little bit about the Dutch, in the Netherlands, this issue about treaties with developing countries and this debate that the Dutch are saying shouldn't have treaties. that Danielle picked up on in terms of developing countries, that somehow it's immoral for the Netherlands to have a treaty that reduces taxation with third world countries.
Yeah, I think last time I was in the Netherlands, I was driving in a car, and I always put on a music radio station, and there was a song of U2, and afterwards the disc jockey said, and this is U2, and they abuse the Netherlands because they get the royalties and they don't pay tax in the Netherlands. And everybody said, that's a disgrace, and that's a shame, and oh gosh. The thing is, they don't pay tax in the Netherlands. Those companies in the Netherlands are conduit companies, so they receive royalties or interest, and in their turn, they pay royalties and interest. And in the Netherlands, under Dutch domestic law, there is no withholding, full stop, on interest and royalty payments, because we think that's what civilized nations should do, right? So, and apart from that, treaties with developing countries, it works both ways. The payments from Netherlands to developing countries are also at reduced rate, and we would only be talking about interest. And apart from that, under Dutch domestic law and under treaties, you get a sparing credit for interest income or royalty income from developing countries in order to facilitate the Dutch taxpayers grant loans and what have you. So basically, there's not a lot. And what would it say? Yeah, we should do something about it. So now the government is saying, yeah, everybody is moaning and groaning. What are we going to do? In my mind, there's not a lot they can really do, because the Netherlands taxes on the spread that is reported between the amounts received and paid. That is fully subject to tax in the Netherlands. It's just a relatively small income. And the way I see it, the only thing you would expect is that in treaties you have anti-conduit rules or a limitation on benefit provision. But just have one country unilaterally say, we're not going to allow any conduit companies anymore, that sounds difficult. And I don't know how they would fit that in the legal system.
Okay. All right. Well, thank you very much, gentlemen. Appreciate it. Thank you, everyone.
Podium.
Yeah. Yeah.
You,
I really like this one, Tom. Sorry.
Okay. Our next panel is going to focus on common U.S. tax planning that occurs in the context of a foreign acquisition of a U.S. multinational group. In particular, the discussion is going to focus on four topics, and they include inversions, intellectual property planning, out from under planning, and CFC dilution. Our two distinguished panelists for this segment include Pat Jackman and Tom Zollo, both with KPMG. As you will recall, Tom had participated earlier today in the OECD panel, and he's back by popular demand from the tax community. Pat Jackman is an international tax principal in KPMG's Washington National Tax Office, where he specializes in cross-border international corporate acquisitions, mergers, internal restructurings, business formations, and joint ventures. Pat is a frequent speaker, writer, and he's co-author of the leading international M&A treatise called U.S. Taxation of International Mergers, Acquisitions, and Joint Ventures. Gentlemen.
Slides with this? Thanks, Larry. So Larry did lay out what Tom and I are going to cover. It is sort of, in some sense, sort of a two-part presentation, one on the acquisition itself of a U.S. company, and we've included in that concept sort of what we call a standalone inversion transaction as well, so there's really not an M&A transaction per se. Sort of the second part is post-acquisition planning. Tom is going to spend his time focused on specifically intangibles planning in a post-acquisition of a U.S. company. I'm going to deal with out from under the U.S. Planning, not so much just focused on IP planning. So as I said, there's sort of two basic transactions that we're going to focus on. And I guess I should have clarified, too, that we're going to spend our time in a situation where the shareholders of the U.S. target are going to have some continuing interest in a foreign acquiring company. And so it's going to raise issues under 7874 and 367. So I'm dividing up the world of acquisitions of U.S. companies into a standalone inversion, so a lot less frequent these days, but there are still situations where a U.S. multinational, in an effort to become a foreign multinational, simply sets up a new foreign company and usually, pursuant to a reverse triangular merger, becomes a subsidiary of this new foreign parent. We'll spend a little bit of time on that, but for the most part, the very strict rules under the substantial business activity requirement under 7874 regs that came out in June of 2012 have significantly curtailed sort of what I call standalone inversions. Other situations, though, where there's an inversion as part of an M&A combination where you've got a U.S., and I'll call it a target, but oftentimes we're dealing with situations where in economic form, the U.S. is really the acquiring party. It's the foreign entity that is the target, but as we know in acquisitions, in terms of the structuring, we can, for the most part, choose the form of the transaction, and so we could set up a new foreign company or even have the foreign target itself acquire the U.S. target, having sort of the minnow acquire the whale, and we'll look at, again, sort of the 7874 and 367 implications of doing that. And we're going to get into a little bit of detail on 7874 requirements, but kind of the shorthand for each of these two inversions, the standalone inversion would, in order to get out of 7874 applying, would have to satisfy the substantial business activity requirement, which essentially, under today's rules, means that they're going to have significant activity, looking at assets, employees, and income, in a particular jurisdiction of the foreign parent. Otherwise, a standalone inversion is not going to work. It's going to be caught by 7874, and the foreign parent will be treated as a U.S. company under 7874B. The M&A transactions are more interesting in terms of sort of your shorthand in terms of when there's a problem under 7874. If the foreign target is not at least 25% of the size of the U.S. target, and this is sort of a rough rule of thumb because there's a lot of particular issues that we'll see in terms of what stock may be counted in the connection with a combination transaction, but to the extent that the foreign target is less than 25% of the U.S. target, typically the shareholders of the U.S. target will have too much of a continuing ownership in either the foreign target or if a new foreign company is set up, and that transaction, when I say too much, using those values, the shareholders of the U.S. target would have 80% or more of the foreign company, and that would be a problem under 7874. The last bullet here is just noting that although most, certainly standalone inversions and probably most combination transactions are structured as stock acquisitions, which if we're focused on 367, then we'd be focused on potential shareholder level gain recognition under 367. We'll talk a little bit about the 367 requirements that apply to an outbound transfer of domestic stock. They're there is a possibility for structuring either one of these so-called inversion transactions as an asset reorganization, which could potentially, since there's an outbound transaction at the corporate level, implicate corporate level tax. And the last thing I'll note, which is an outgrowth of the legislation that implemented 7874, is there's a potential for an excise tax under 4985. Oftentimes, in terms of a rough hand, if you're focused on percentages of continuing ownership, if the continuing ownership of the U.S. target shareholders is 80%, like I said, your inversion is not effective. To the extent that you're at the 60% threshold, so that the U.S. target shareholders have a continuing ownership of 60% or more, then there are some limitations on your post-acquisition planning. And in addition, and sometimes this gets sort of lost in M&A transactions, there's a potential excise tax under 4985 that applies at that ownership threshold. Okay, so with the notion that you have to sort of walk before you can run, just some of the basic definitions, and we'll focus a little bit on the three requirements that would involve 7874 applying. So in terms of the statute itself, 7874A talks about to the extent that you've got an expatriated entity, and so this is focused on whether the U.S. company, the U.S. target, is going to be treated as an expatriated company. We'll talk about when that is, three requirements in the next section, but an expatriated entity would have limits on its ability to use some of its attributes, NOLs, foreign tax credits, to absorb some of the cost of the out from under post-acquisition planning, including intangibles planning as well. In terms of the three requirements, there's a focus on is there an acquisition of substantially all of the assets of a U.S. target? Typically, this is not an issue, or meaning that typically this is not a requirement that you spend that much time on, although in sort of in the bankruptcy context, if you've got a U.S. company that is sort of selling off of its pieces, and some of its pieces are being acquired by a foreign company, and there's some sort of rollover with creditors, you could have a situation where you might be fighting about whether there has been an acquisition of substantially all the assets of a U.S. target. The second requirement, where we do spend a lot of time focusing on, is the so-called ownership requirement, which I've mentioned before, which is looking to the U.S. target shareholders, how much of a continuing ownership do they have in the foreign company? And the two threshold ownership percentages are 80%. At an 80% threshold, the U.S. or the foreign parent would not be treated as foreign, to be treated as U.S. under 7874. At 60%, potential application of the excise tax and some limits on being able to shelter post-acquisition gain. The third requirement, which again typically arises in a standalone inversion situation, is involving whether the substantial business activity in the jurisdiction of the foreign parent. And just a couple of words on that. The requirement has gone through, there's a bit of history here in the sense that initially, there was a safe harbor with facts and circumstances. The safe harbor was at a 10% threshold, focusing on assets, income, and employees. We went through a period where the substantial business activity was solely facts and circumstances. You had some of the, maybe other companies too, but you had some drilling companies that went to the UK that were able to have a significant enough presence in the UK that people, advisors could get comfortable that they met the facts and circumstances. There was a lot of hemming and hawing about how the absence of a safe harbor was making it very difficult to analyze 7874 issues. And so then the IRS dumped a pretty significant requirement in the sense that the threshold for satisfying the substantial business activity requirement went to a 25% threshold, and rather than being a safe harbor, it was a bright line test. So typically in my area, I generally start with the assumption that you're not going to be able to do a standalone inversion, although I will note that a relatively recent public deal involving Liberty Global, Virgin Media, the advisors indicate there that they anticipate that that new foreign parent would be able to satisfy these 25% threshold tests. So there's clearly some transactions that can still satisfy that test. Okay, here's just setting up a simple situation to analyze the ownership test. And you might think that, you know, this seems pretty straightforward. You've told me that the thresholds are 80% and 60%. So I look at the U.S. target shareholders and I see what their continuing ownership is. What has made this area extremely complicated is the various anti-abuse rules in 78, 74, and a relatively, well, not that recent anymore, notice 2009-78 takes a fairly expanded notion of these anti-abuse rules. And in a lot of situations, the stock ownership by the foreign shareholders, this 20.1%, depending on what they're contributing to the foreign acquiring company, that stock ownership may not be counted. And so it's not as simple as just sort of looking at the end picture and seeing what the relative ownership is. As a for example, oftentimes, excuse me, a lot of times in the PE area where we've got, for the most part, a cashing out of the U.S. target shareholders, but there's some continuing ownership by management or even a, you know, one of the shareholders in the U.S. target, those situations where even though it's largely a cash transaction, because the rules for not counting stock can discount stock issued in exchange for cash, that stock ownership of the foreign shareholders, or in many cases it's the PE fund setting up a foreign entity to equity fund an acquisition vehicle. So, it, like I said, the ownership requirement is often deceptively simple, but because of the anti-abuse rules, often becomes a problem. So I mentioned that in June of 2012, the IRS came out with a set of new regs. We'll spend a little bit of time on those. The primary aspect of the 2012 regs was to come up with a bright line test under the substantial business activity requirement. That is that to the extent that the threshold for not having a problem under 7874, so trying to have significant enough activity in the jurisdiction of the foreign parent, ratcheted up to a 25% threshold as part of those June regs. The other aspect of that reg package was dealing with options. Options are something that are a focus actually of the ownership requirement, and there's a rule that spells out that in terms of what options are, how they factor into the ownership test is that you look at the spread value between exercise price and value of the options. That tells you that you'll count that value for purposes of the continuing ownership of the U.S. target. It goes both ways. So you're counting options that the shareholders in the foreign company would have too in a combination transaction. But one issue that had been out there is, well, what do you do with voting rights? And do you just apply the same sort of test with options that you do for value, meaning assigning voting equal to the spread? Do you say that there's no voting? And essentially the regs came out and said that for purposes of options, you're not going to count the vote at all, except in if there's a principal purpose to avoid 78-74. So this is just detailing, and I'm on slide, I guess it's 132 in your package, that just details the substantial business activity requirement, the 25% threshold. A question that often comes up is, when am I measuring this test? And if I'm close to the line, what happens if I go down after a particular date? Is there any way to manipulate the various requirements? And so each of the requirements focuses, or the two of the requirements look at a one-year period, so-called testing period, 1 year prior to the acquisition date for determining whether there's 25% in the case of employee compensation. And just for purposes of the percentage, what you're comparing the percentages to are the activity that I have in the foreign parent jurisdiction, including it's the so-called expanded affiliated group is the nomenclature, but the foreign parent or subs of the foreign parent to the extent that they've got on a total basis, do they have 25% of their employees as a, for example, let's use UK as an example, do I have 25% of my employees in the UK, do I have 25% of my overall employee compensation attributable to UK-based employees? Assets and income the same. One point on the income that I'll note is, this is another thing that has sort of a history associated with it, is when I'm looking at income within a country, so again, let's use UK as an example, am I just focused on sales that originate from that country? Or am I focused on sales with respect to customers in that particular country? And in the June 2012 package, the IRS said, no, it's customers within the country, not just sales that originate. That is a stricter interpretation of having sufficient income. So now let's get to a transaction that is our M&A transaction, because I think at least a lot of my time I've said, well, standalone inversions for the most part because of the substantial business activity requirement, very difficult to occur. So most of the time we're analyzing 78-74 and 367 in the context of an M&A combination. And so what is shown here is a situation where we've got U.S. target, foreign target. U.S. target in the simple example is shown to be worth $100. Foreign target is worth $70. So assuming it's just a pure stock acquisition, the combined company should be worth $170. And so I would say, okay, let's do 78-74 analysis first. The shareholders, and I'm looking to all of the shareholders of the U.S. target. This is not like 367, where I'm focused on potential gain recognition for my U.S. shareholders. For 78-74, I would look at my U.S. target shareholders. If I take 100 over 170, that will be less than 60%, and that's sort of the one of the magic dividing lines for 78-74. So in this case, 78-74 would have no application to this combination transaction. Again, assuming that I'm not having to disregard some stock under one of the anti-abuse rules. Just a quick point, and then I'll let Tom do some of the post-acquisition planning. Just a quick point under 367. So we've, under these simple facts, we've managed to avoid a 78-74 problem. But then the question is, well, what is the treatment of my shareholders? In particular, now 367 is focused on U.S. shareholders, and to the extent for an outbound transfer of domestic stock, which this would be, so I didn't describe it too well, but FHC is the acquiring company that's been set up as part of this combination transaction. FHC is going to acquire both FT and UST, in reverse triangular mergers, for example. And so the U.S. target shareholders are going to have an interest in FHC. That's an outbound transfer of stock of UST to FHC. And one of the requirements under 367 is there's a relative value test. You look at the relative value of FHC, and for this purpose you would count foreign target as well. You would look at the relative value of FHC as compared with the U.S. target. FHC would need to be worth more than the U.S. target. And I've already said that U.S. target's worth 100. FT is only worth 70, so that's not going to be the case. So on these particular facts, no 78-74 problem, but the U.S. shareholders have gain recognition under 367. So sort of the dividing line in the 367 requirements for outbound transfers of domestic stock, there is this relative value test. There's also a 50% receipt test, which is focused on, are U.S. persons receiving more than 50% of the vote or value of the foreign company? That requirement would probably be violated as well under these facts. And again, so that the consequences of that 50% threshold are gain recognition to the U.S. shareholders. So there are a lot of sort of traps, if you will, that need to be run in terms of getting that U.S. target to be a subsidiary of a foreign target. And I think what you'll see is that all of those various complications tend to be worth it because of the ability to do a lot of planning that is much easier with a foreign multinational as opposed to a U.S. multinational. I guess in the presentation before, they talked about how there's inbound financing structures that are allowing you to base erode your U.S. tax base. That is one of the advantages, but some of the other advantages are just getting some of your operations, foreign operations, out from under the U.S. and not have to run that income through the U.S. So I'll turn it over to Tom for IP planning.
Okay, thanks. You know, Pat, at some point I looked away from the clock and 30 minutes somehow ended up off the clock, so it really is a cruel taskmaster. You know, when you go through either the in-house inversion or the M&A inversion that Pat just described, it still doesn't solve much of a problem for you, because if what you had at the start was a U.S. parent of a multinational group, you now have a U.S. holding company with a foreign parent, but the U.S. holding company owns a bunch of non-U.S. companies. And so all the earnings of those foreign subsidiaries under the United States are going to be subject to residual U.S. tax under our credit system as you bring those earnings up. And notwithstanding Case's generous depiction of the United States as a tax haven, I don't think anybody thinks that the United States is a particularly attractive holding company location. So invariably, when you have this kind of situation, people's thoughts turn to how they can extract value, perhaps have some base erosion and profit shifting, from the entities that are under the United States so that those earnings can avoid passing through the United States on their way up to the foreign parent and ultimately to its shareholders. And the first type of structure I'm going to describe we call here the foreign tracking partnership. I don't see any of my pass-through partners here, so I will call it a mixing bowl partnership as well. Probably its more common name. And essentially what is going on in this transaction is the notion that we are going to integrate the international operations of the foreign parent and the U.S. company through a partnership that is formed by the two of them. But we will use special allocations so as to bring value back to the United States in the form of relatively higher taxed foreign earnings and have the relatively lower taxed foreign earnings, by and large, bypass the United States where they might be subject to residual tax and go directly to the foreign parent. So one correction I'll make to this slide, we say that, this is the first sub-bullet, that the U.S. company is in an excess foreign tax credit position. I mean, in fact, this is more powerful when the U.S. is in an excess limitation provision. That is, it's being subjected to residual U.S. tax on its foreign earnings. You know, as you would expect in this case, both the United States and the foreign parent probably own intellectual property that they develop themselves. They have some operations that attract a high rate of tax, some that attract a medium rate of tax, some that may attract little or no tax. And they want to integrate their operations. The reason foreign parent acquired the U.S. company is that their operations are synergetic or complementary in some fashion. And this partnership is one alternative for bringing them together. Now, what we're going to do, though, going forward, is instead of this having to be a straight-up partnership, we'll create two or more pools of income in the partnership. There will be a high-tax pool of income that will be disproportionately allocated back to the U.S. parent, or U.S. company in this example, and a low-tax portion of income that will be disproportionately allocated back up to the foreign parent. Okay, so you know, what are some of the issues about getting into this kind of structure? Well, one question that you always ask with respect to any transaction is business purpose. Is there a business purpose for this? And I'd submit that there is a business purpose. You know, foreign parent acquired U.S. company for a reason, and it wanted to integrate the operations. It's unlikely that they're going to want to have two parallel universes, throughout the world that are operating, and so they're going to want to bring those operations together over time. This partnership is simply one of the available ways to start mixing the management and assets of the two businesses. Second inevitable issue is valuation. The U.S. company and the foreign parent are both putting assets down into this partnership. You have to make sure that you're properly valuing the assets going down so that the interests that they get back are equal in value to what's been put down. Now, when both of them own intellectual property, there's one additional issue, which is, when do you do the valuation or how do you assess the valuation? Although a U.S. company can drop IP into a foreign partnership without a 367D toll charge, this still is a transaction among related parties, and therefore Section 482 ought to apply. Now, Section 482 doesn't apply to make it taxable immediately, but I think it certainly applies to say that the IRS can look at the profitability of the foreign partnership going forward in assessing whether the United States has gotten enough for the IP that it put down, and on the other hand, it could look at whether the foreign parent has gotten too much for the IP that it put down based upon the ongoing profitability of the enterprise. As I mentioned, this approach depends upon the use of special allocations. Whenever you have special allocations, you have to ask about whether they have substantial economic effect. They certainly will have economic effect because we'll be careful to do our bookkeeping so as to credit each participant's accounts with the appropriate amounts and debit them with the appropriate amounts. And then upon liquidation, they'll get what's in their capital account. Whether the allocations, though, are substantial might be more of an issue. I think you have to pay some attention to whether the allocations you've come up with have a meaningful likely effect on the pre-tax amounts that the participants are likely to get absent using special allocations. And I think in many cases they will for the following reason. The higher tax operations that the U.S. company is taking a disproportionate interest in are probably where you're making and selling things, which likely are the places that have higher tax rates. The IP income, which is likely to be more lightly taxed, is probably going to be disproportionately allocated to the foreign parent. That income is, although it probably has a higher expected value, more risky than the returns that you're giving to manufacturing and distribution activities. So there probably is a meaningful change in both parties' risk-return profile. Once you've done these allocations, you have to ask how the foreign tax credits get allocated. The allocation of foreign tax credits will never have economic effect. And under the regulations that came out last year, essentially the foreign tax credits have to get swooped along with the pool of assets to which they relate. Another issue is how you deal with Section 704C. And I don't think, in this audience we're going to go in depth into Section 704C, but suffice it to say that in this kind of transaction, if the U.S. company has substantial, valuable, self-created IP, there's going to be a class of assets that's going to have a substantial disparity between the fair market value at the time of the drop-down and the tax basis associated with it. And the same may be true of the foreign parent. That's going to raise the question of whether you can just use the traditional method of kind of allocating these pools on a straight-up basis, or whether you have to look more deeply and ask whether this has the effect of shifting tax consequences, in which case you'd likely have to make curative allocations of income. And then, finally, with respect to this structure, since we are mixing the interests and the assets, I think care has to be taken as to the way that you distribute cash out of this to make sure that you don't run afoul of the various disguised sale rules. So likely that's going to mean pooling the cash as well is the way you pool your income and making sure that the distributions come out in accordance to the particular pools to which they relate. A second approach is something that's commonly referred to as withering on the vine. So after this acquisition, the foreign parent and the U.S. company probably both have a substantial overlap in the countries where they do business. And they're going to start to eliminate redundancies. They're going to start operating the businesses as one business. People are going to leave the business. New people will join the business. There's going to be capital expansion. And the question is, where do you do that? And if we assume that foreign parent is a rational investor, I think pretty clearly it would prefer to make the investment in the foreign entities that it owns directly rather than the ones through the United States. And why is that? It's because both GrowCo and ShrinkCo in this example are alike in a lot of ways. They benefit from exactly the same management. They have access to the same sorts of resources. Their competitive posture vis-a-vis independent companies is the same. What's the difference between them? The difference is if foreign parent has an exemption system, GrowCo's income can pass up to foreign parent without any additional tax at the foreign parent level. If ShrinkCo has profits and it passes profits back to the United States, you have to go through the U.S. foreign tax credit system to see whether there's going to be yet another bite of tax before profits can go up to the foreign parent company. So, based on that, rationally, new opportunities are likely to get filtered to GrowCo. Now, in this regard, there's a case that is very helpful in one sense, but also cautionary in another sense. That's the Hospital Corporation of America case. For those of you who don't follow transfer pricing cases all that closely, Hospital Corporation of America was a case in which the Saudi royal family approached HCA, the Hospital Corporation of America, headquartered in Tennessee, and said that they wanted them to build a hospital in Saudi Arabia that would be kind of a state-of-the-art American-style hospital. The management of HCA said, well, we aren't really all that interested in doing it ourselves. However, we do have a Cayman Islands affiliate that we think would be, just optimal for you to enter into this contract with, which the Saudi royal family did. With the assistance of the U.S. company, the Cayman Islands company then went and built the hospital and got paid by the Saudi government. Now, the IRS came in and said initially that the thing was a sham. Tax court found that the transaction wasn't a sham, that there was substance to the Cayman corporation, that you had to respect it. A second argument that the IRS made was that the United States had transferred intangible property to the Cayman affiliate. And what the court held on that was that no, there was not yet any property. All there was a business proposition that at that point had not been reduced to a property right, and that the HCA group could allocate that opportunity to whichever affiliate it wanted. And it was only once that the Cayman company entered into the contract with the Saudi government that any property right arose. So what that says is nobody owns future opportunities. Corporate groups can assign them wherever they want. Now, that sounds really great. That's the good part of the case. The bad part of the case is that the tax court recognized that to the extent that the United States was assisting the Cayman company in the performance of its obligations, it was entitled to proper compensation for what it brought to bear. So if it had IP that the Cayman company was using, it was entitled to compensation for that. if the Cayman company relied on management services from the United States, the U.S. was entitled to that. And on that basis, the court gave 75% of the consolidated profit to the United States, 25% to the Cayman company. So that is the caution here, that while you can strategically place new opportunities in GrowCo, and over time you would expect that ShrinkCo would wither on the vine as its assets depreciate and employees wander off, this is a strategy that obviously will take some time. Pat?
Thanks, Tom. So obviously Tom was describing out from under planning, but he was focused more on the IP, specific IP aspects of out from under planning. The next part of the discussion will be more focused on sort of entire foreign operations that are under the U.S. and moving those out from under the U.S. and exploring how one thinks about that sort of out from under transaction. So in terms of just looking at the structure, so this is our structure after we've had an acquisition of a U.S. company by a foreign company. We've got our FS, we've got our CFC still under the U.S. It's probably obvious why there's a desire to get it out from the U.S., but just to go through that quickly, to the extent that FS is distributing earnings back to USP, including sort of temporary loans back to the U.S., so potential deemed dividends. We've got residual U.S. tax. Obviously, we read about that in the paper all the time. We hear about U.S. multinationals like Apple, et cetera, that have all of this trapped money offshore that they can't bring back to the U.S. The other issue, of course, is to the extent that the foreign operations are generating subpart F income, to the extent that they're out from under the U.S., they're obviously not subject to the U.S. anti-deferral rules. Potentially, there are certainly other jurisdictions that have anti-deferral rules, but much less restrictive than the U.S.'s subpart F rules in general. One other thing that is out there that's a bit of a wild card is just international tax reform, because at least with U.S. residual tax, not as easy as it once was, but oftentimes taxpayers were able to create low and high tax pools, bring back their high tax pools, leave their low tax pools. And so the impact of U.S. residual tax prior to a lot of FTC reform maybe wasn't as dramatic as it's gotten to now. But of course, international tax reform would potentially make it even more advantageous to not have foreign operations under the U.S. So that's the reason why you want to get out from under. In terms of how one thinks about out from under planning, it's pretty straightforward in the sense that they kind of fall into two basic categories. Is there an ability to reduce your value in the U.S., so that's called value extraction, or is it some sort of value for value transaction? And I don't know how, certainly the partnership structure was a value for value in the sense that you were putting assets into a partnership. I suppose the withering on the vine is thinking about value erosion, so maybe that is value extraction over time. But within value for value transactions, there's sort of subcategories. So you may have your operating assets that presumably are growth assets. You may want to swap those growth assets for assets that are not appreciating. And so that would be, and we'll see this in the transaction, that would be transferring those operating assets for, say, preferred stock or for a note. Those are obviously assets that would not appreciate. It's a fixed return as opposed to an appreciating return. Mixing bull, typically those transactions are 100% of your assets being exchanged for this fixed return asset. A mixing bull is, just by the nature of it, is swapping sort of a portion of your assets to get a portion of other assets. So there's some immediate transfer, but it's more of a sharing, and maybe there will be a swap over time after various disguise sale rules and things like that, that time period elapses. And then the last transaction in value for value is, okay, I can understand how moving my appreciating assets out from under the U.S., maybe that's good in the sense that I'm controlling my problem. I'm not subjecting future appreciation to U.S. tax. But maybe I'm going to have a current problem. And sort of an add-on to a value for value is there any way to avoid the subpart F regime by some sort of decontrolling transaction of, in my simple example, was FS. So what, you know, there's all sorts of different transactions that illustrate these various out from under transactions. What we're gonna walk through quickly is just one example that illustrates a few of the points in terms of what people think about in out from under planning, which we call CFC dilution. So just to set up the ownership structure, I've made it maybe a little bit more realistic and a little bit more complicated. Now, rather than having the U.S. just hold a single CFC, there's multiple holding companies, and I've got my operating assets in CFC OpCo. This is actually a relatively standard foreign ownership structure or CFC ownership structure. With so many companies trying to have their top-tier holding company, when I say top-tier, the top-tier CFC holding company be a so-called clean entity that doesn't have any current earnings and profits, and have the earnings and profits of the operating company flowing into Holdco too. So again, fairly typical structure. And so the transaction that we're going to illustrate is first a situation where assets are contributed by the foreign parent to CFC Holdco 1. Now that may be a little bit counterintuitive. We've just talked about how we're trying to get assets out from under the U.S. A couple of points. One, this is not putting assets through the U.S. into the CFC. This is a direct contribution by the FP into CFC Holdco 1, so it's not increasing the value of the U.S. and foreign assets. And more importantly, the goal of this contribution, and just a caveat that for the moment we'll ignore why there might be business rationale, just as Tom said, there has to be a business purpose for a number of the transactions. This probably doesn't need a business purpose in terms of fitting within the non-recognition regime, so it's going to be an easier threshold. But FP is going to contribute assets to CFC Holdco 1, and the idea is they're going to take back a sufficient ownership interest in CFC Holdco 1 that CFC Holdco 1 is no longer going to be a CFC. That's sort of the decontrol transaction. This goes a little bit beyond that, just to illustrate a point. It's taking back a sufficient interest in CFC Holdco 1 that USP is no longer a U.S. shareholder. So not only is CFC Holdco 1 not a CFC following this dilution transaction, USP is no longer a U.S. shareholder in CFC Holdco 1. One important point about this transaction is that normally if you've got a U.S. shareholder exchanging CFC stock and taking back non-CFC stock, if that's a non-recognition transaction, 367B ensures that you can't leave CFC status and become a non-CFC without having a 367B income inclusion. But a dilution transaction is different. USP is not exchanging an interest in CFC Holdco 1. Now there is a caveat in the bullets here that you just have to analyze whether there's some sort of recapitalization going on with respect to CFC Holdco 1, that one could argue that USP does have an exchange. The other sort of aspect of these dilution transactions that we've seen, and I think actually the relatively recent 367A5 regs seem to have focused on this, is situations where there might be an exchange that goes on, let's say as part of an F reorganization, and then a subsequent dilution transaction. And I think that in particular for an F reorganization, people might have been taking the view that the F is stands alone, and the fact that USP has an exchange as part of the F, that coupled with the dilution, that would not be, for 367B purposes, coupled with a dilution transaction. Anyways, so what we've done here is we've tried to dilute CFC Holdco 1 so USP is no longer a US shareholder. And then the next step is the swap of assets. So CFC Holdco 2 owned operating assets, and CFC Holdco 2 is going to sell those assets to FP in exchange for, it could be, let's say it's a note from FP. And so that's a swap, as I said, of appreciating assets for a fixed return asset. Typically, and this often applies in a freeze transaction, is there's a trade-off in a freeze transaction. You're giving up future appreciation, but you're swapping that for not only a preferred return, but usually a current income return. And oftentimes, current income returns result in subpart F. Here, you do have that current income return, meaning CFC Holdco 2 had operating assets previously that were appreciating. It now has a note from FP. That interest from FP potentially would generate subpart F income, but for the fact that CFC Holdco 1 is not a CFC. There's been this dilution transaction. They're no longer a CFC. So you've been able to, through a dilution transaction, sort of finesse an immediate consequence on taking a frozen asset back in exchange for appreciating assets. Let me just go to the last slide here and focus on some fairly technical aspects of 367B. We won't dwell on it too much, but it's another sort of fallout or favorable consequence that follows from USP not being a US shareholder in CFC Holdco 1. And just to state the rule, let's ignore potential recast issues. Let's assume that this is happening at some later point down the road, or just to understand how the 367B rules work. So CFC Holdco, the transaction, and this is where it says potential exit structure. What it describes is CFC Holdco 2 and CFC Holdco 1 both doing inbound reorganizations. Because another aspect, and maybe it's a third category, I described out from under planning as either about value extraction or value for value transactions. There's maybe sort of an in-between, which is on day one, it's a value for value transaction, but over time, it becomes a transaction that leads itself to value reduction. One transaction that is just noted in the prior bullet points that's similar to that is when you have your CFC purchasing hook stock in the US parent. To the extent that, and I'm digressing a bit, but just quickly on hook stock, to the extent that a CFC is buying hook stock, and just to be clear, we've got, we have legislation that came in 2010 that made purchasing hook stock from foreign parents much less advantageous, or at least there's a, generally speaking, a toll charge for taking back hook stock. But hook stock, and that's partly why 304 treats it as a redemption, it has an aspect of value reduction because you're taking back stock in a U.S. parent. If you eventually liquidate the CFC, that is value reduction. Here, it's comparable because CFC Holdco 2 and CFC Holdco 1, if they're able to do an inbound transaction, you are bringing assets back into the U.S., but typically in these structures, the foreign parent is in a jurisdiction where USP can distribute a note. Because a lot of value reduction by itself is not the problem, typically, in that there's, in many, you know, we know that in the UK, satisfying a 12-month holding period, you can pull dividends out of the US at a 0% withholding tax. The problem is being able to pull an appreciated asset out of the US to the foreign parent in a simple transaction because you're triggering 311B gains, so you're having US corporate level tax. With this transaction, and let me just quickly deal with 367B. So CFC Holdco 2, if they do an inbound transaction like this inbound F reorganization, normally what would happen is that to the extent that you had a U.S. shareholder, including if the U.S. shareholder held its stock through a foreign company, that you would have a all EMP pickup. But because there's no U.S. shareholder of CFC Holdco, there's no all earnings and profits pickup, even though CFC Holdco 2 has done an inbound transaction. CFC Holdco 1 also does an inbound transaction. Here, one, when you don't have a U.S. shareholder under 367B, normal 367B is that the non-U.S. shareholder has to pick up gain with respect to the stock of CFC Holdco 1. But you have an ability as sort of a minority or a small U.S. shareholder to instead include the all EMP amount. And in this case, CFC Holdco 1 doesn't have the EMP. So just very quickly backing up, CFC Holdco 2 had lots of earnings and profits from having disposed of its operating assets. It disposed of them for a fixed return asset in the form of this note. That generated lots of earnings and profits, and the note took back was a cost basis in that note. CFC Holdco 1 is a so-called remains a clean entity without any earnings and profits. So in this transaction where you've transferred appreciated assets for a fixed return asset with fair market value basis and generated lots of earnings, and you've done this dilution transaction, you don't have a pickup with respect to those earnings that you normally would have in a situation where you're inbounding a CFC. So, I mean, there's lots of issues that need to be sorted out, but it is a transaction that reduces value ultimately without a U.S. pickup. Thank you. I don't know, Tom, if you wanted to say anything.
Nope, I'm good.
Pat and Tom, thank you very much for those comments on out from under planning and such. Next up is a 10-minute afternoon break. The difficulty is going to be getting everyone back in 10 minutes. I understand there are snacks across the Greenberg Lounge, so perhaps grab something, come on back in, because we're going to start up again in 10 minutes. Thank you very much.